Color grading in Premiere Pro is easier than ever before in version 25, and it's got to do with a little thing that Adobe have added recently called color management. Now, you might be completely new to color grading, or maybe you know your way around the Lumetri tab a little bit, or you might even be a whiz with LUTS looking to get a little bit more hands-on with grading. Either way, the waypoints for a successful grade are all the same, and to understand how to get the most out of Premiere's grading tools, we must first take a brief look at the process of color grading. There are a couple of steps involved and some nuance in the terminology. Now, to break it down really simply, there's two main parts. There's color correction and color grading. Color correction takes our footage from the camera, generally in some flavor of log, that's logarithmic footage, the flat grayish looking footage that your camera captures, and more on that later, and it takes that log footage and then corrects it to a delivery color space, most likely Rec 709. Now, if you really are fresh to all of this, then recording formats and color spaces can get a little bit confusing, but don't let it put you off. A really simple way to think about it is like traveling to another country and exchanging some of your local currency at the airport for the currency of the country that you're going to, so that once you're there, you're prepped and you're ready to hit the ground running. You start with your flat, colorless log footage, which is not a delivery color space. You tell your color management where you're headed, i.e. Rec 709. It does some sweet little background corrections and then sends you on your way to the land of vivid colors and high contrast. And then there's grading, which is the creative look that you apply over the top of your corrected footage. This is where you dial in the mood, the look, the feel, the nuance, the vibe, the... But you have to correct before you can get to this grading stage. So now you know the order of things, let's dive into Premiere Pro and we'll have a look at the process in action. Now, if your Premiere layout doesn't look like this, don't fret. Just get up to this button here, then select the color tab. Once you're in it, if your scopes don't pop up, then click onto them over here next to the effects controls panel. I'll walk you through the scopes I like to work with shortly, but for now, let's just get used to having them there with us like a weirdly comforting safety blanket made of data points. So over here on the right, we have the Lumetri color tab, and this is where you do all of your correction and grading. And in the 25 version of Premiere, this is where we play around with our new color management tools. Select the settings menu up at the top of the tab and navigate to the project dropdown and select auto detect log color space. And you'll see that all of a sudden my dull gray footage here has a little bit of color and contrast. That's because it's being corrected from my flavor of log, which in this case is red log 3G10 in a wide gamut, to my desired color space, which is Rec 709. If you're unsure and wondering what your desired color space is, then go with Rec 709. It's what the vast majority of projects will be delivered in. Now, it's also worth noting the jump you're seeing in the scopes when you turn this on as well. It gives a really good visual demonstration of how log footage works to compress all of that data into this small band where the highlights and shadows aren't in danger of clipping, allowing for heaps of room to expand and manipulate that data in the post-production process. With this particular bit of footage, you'll see there's a hard line on the black point of my scopes down here, and that's just because I have these black bars in the image because I've got a 2:35:1 aspect ratio piece of footage sitting in a 16:9 frame. So don't worry too much about that. Now, if you've just clicked into the blank space on your timeline and don't have a clip selected, you won't see anything in the source clip menu here. But once you do select your clip, you can see that you have some more options. Namely, you can easily add an input LUT here, which you might want to use if you have a specific correction LUT for your camera. By default, you'll be using your media color space here as the input, but you can also override that input color space here if you have a reason to do so. Right now, let's leave it as it is. It's corrected from red log to Rec 709. So as a beginner, that's the crux of the color management tools. Well, as much as I think you need to know right now anyway. There is a ton of really technical color science stuff going on underneath the hood. What I want you to get out of it is to use it as the basis for correcting your footage, especially if you're regularly working with log and raw formats and want to save a couple of steps. Now you can turn that off and do your entire color grade from your base log format without color management or even a correction LUT, but you'll be doing that manually for every single shot, and then you're going to be coming back in and making further tweaks to your correction anyway, not to mention the actual color grade, so why not save yourself that time and tick the box? Now, speaking of saving yourself a little bit of time, this video is brought to you by Envato, the unlimited creative subscription. The broadest range of categories, everything that you need to make great videos. Follow the link in the description and start creating now. All right, so back in the edit tab of Lumetri Color, we can now start to look at our grade. Now, your default scopes might be set to the waveform up here, and waveform is a great tool for checking footage on set when you're shooting. It's an in-camera scope that I use all the time. However, I don't actually think it's all that great for grading. I much prefer the parade, which plots the luminance of the image and splits the red, green, and blue channels out, helping you in monitoring your image whilst you're tweaking the luminance levels and color balance. So I picked this particular shot to demonstrate these techniques on, as it offers areas of heavy contrast in the luminance levels between places like the window and the clothing of the subjects. There's vibrant colors, mixed lighting, and the color balance at a starting point is not bad, but it's a little bit off, so we need to correct some things there. Now, we have actually corrected our footage to Rec 709, but I'm still going to start in the Basic Corrections tab, as I think we can get our image to an even better starting point. Not every image is captured perfectly, exposed correctly, has a correct white balance, and so on and so forth, so it is important to know how to correct for those things. I've done an okay job with this bit of footage, but there is definitely room for some improvement, that's for sure. We'll start with our levels, and what that means is we're looking at our luminance and our contrast within the image. Exposure-wise, it's pretty good, but I do want to correct the hotspots in the window, so I'll bring my highlight slider down and also do the same with my whites. I'm looking to pull the clipped data back from the top of the graph to give us a little wiggle room. With this image, I'm never going to regain that data at the top, but I can soften the effect it has on the overall image. Next, I want to bring my shadows back up a little, and I'll do this with the shadows and blacks slider, starting with the blacks. Note that in this basic corrections tab, the blacks and whites sliders are referring to the parts of the image that are at the very edges of our luminance ranges, so the very top and very bottom of the graph. The shadows and highlights refer to the mid parts of our image, and you can see that demonstrated in how the scopes sort of change and react as I move these sliders around. So with those little tweaks, I'm happy with how our scopes are looking, but I made the image a little bit washed out in the program monitor here, so we can bring some contrast in. This will expand our light sections away from our dark sections, hence why I've worked to bring the light and dark areas of our scopes closer together to give us room again when we start expanding them, which is now when we introduce some contrast. So let's use our contrast sliders and see that in action. At any point in this process, you can toggle these switches off and on to check your work against your starting point or against each step in the process. Get in the habit of doing this. It's a good way to keep track of what you're doing and where you're going. I do this all the time. Okay, I'm happy with that correction in terms of our luminance, but there can probably be a little bit more contrast in the image, but we can address that once we've done our color balance. The balance phase is looking at the color balance of the image, the white balance in terms of the temperature. Is it feeling too cool? Is it feeling too warm? And the tint of the image, is it sitting a little green or pushing a little bit magenta? It's best to introduce your saturation first and then balance the image once the colors have been saturated to your desired levels. So let's do that now. I'll increase the saturation by about 15%. Now I'll address the balance. We can look at our RGB parade over here, and it tells a story that is pretty balanced, but it does show that the blue channel in the mids and the upper mids is sitting slightly higher than the red and green channel. So we can grab our temperature slider and warm it up a little bit. That looks good, but it has skewed the red channel a little bit, so we can counter that with the tint slider by introducing a little green. It's going to be very minimal in this case. Check off and on, and yeah, that's looking pretty tasty. Now this is a pretty nicely corrected image just using the basic set of tools. The colors are richer, there's a little more drama in the shadows and the mids, and we've corrected for some of the heat we were getting from the windows in our highlights. Honestly, for a lot of projects, you could leave it there and call it a day, but let's dive a little bit deeper into the rest of the tools available to us here, and we can take this corrected image into a more stylized direction. The next tab down is the Creative tab, and it's mostly designed around creative LUTs, which are totally fine to use, and we actually have a whole heap of them on Envato that you can download and use in your projects. These are LUTs that are made by filmmakers and photographers the world over and are designed to quickly take your corrected footage to some really cinematic places with the click of a button. And of course, it isn't just LUTs. Envato is stacked full of assets perfect for filmmakers like stock footage, video templates for Premiere Pro and After Effects, and high quality authentic music for your videos. There's heaps more as well. So check out Envato today, and to learn more, I'll pop a link down below. Now, as this video is about grading from scratch here in Premiere Pro, we're going to skip the Creative tab and LUTs, and instead we're going to get creative in the Curves, Color Wheels, and the Vignette tabs. So in our RGB curves here, making sure the white dot is selected, which is our luminance values, we're going to address some of the milkiness we're still getting in the shadows here. That's because I boosted them from the floor. This is another way of introducing contrast. However, it lets us have more control over where we want the contrast to appear in our image instead of doing it globally. We'll create a point in the middle of the graph here, which is the midpoint of our image tonally, then take the darker areas at the bottom of the image of the graph and move them under the line, thus making those areas darker without affecting our mids and highlights. Now, as we're up to the creative part of the process, we can start to use these curve tools here to shift the mood and tone of our image creatively. And one of the things I really like about the location that we shot this footage is this green wall and this green print over on the left. And what I want to do is kind of accentuate that a little bit more to offset that orange color. So I'm going to switch to our red channel here and just shift a little bit of red out of the image, thus accentuating that blue area. Moving down to the hue versus saturation curve, I'm going to further accentuate that blue-green wall by adding a couple of points around the graph where those colors sit. I can then drag the midpoint, so this green color I like, up the graph, and that will increase the saturation on that specific hue. It's subtle, but it is there. I also don't really like the intensity of the yellow coming off this lamp up here and also onto the guy's shoulder from the overhead lights. So I'll create some more points around the yellow and desaturate them just a little. We can off and on just that change to see what we've done, and we can also, of course, off and on the curves tab in general, and I'm pretty happy with this. I'm happy to move on to the next part. Now, down in our color wheels and match tab, you have three wheels and three corresponding sliders. Move up and down on the sliders to increase or decrease the luminance of the shadows, mids, or the highlights. And then click and drag the center of the wheel to push those areas of the image into different shades of color. So as this image naturally has a bit of teal and orange in it, I've already boosted that blue, green, teal section. So let's keep pushing in that direction by adding a little bit of blue in the shadows and pushing the mids and highlights towards orange. We can go pretty far with this though, so kind of do it slightly to start with. We're definitely getting into stylized territory here as we do this. To address our shift in contrast during this creative grading section, we can always go back up to our basic correction section and play around there, or in our curves, but I kind of like to keep it linear as we're going down these little shelves here, so I like to make the final tweaks I can in these sliders in the color wheels and match section. I'm going to boost the mids again as they've gotten a little bit muddy, and that should also bring up our shadows as well. Finally, I think I'm going to add a little vignette to the image just to take the heat off the metal benches here. In the vignette tab, the amount slider creates a dark vignette when pushed in the negative direction, so to the left, and a light one when pushed positive. We'll darken ours off a little and also add some feathering to make it a little bit more subtle. And there we go. That's our final stylized grade. Let's recap how we got here. We first let color management correct our footage into our desired delivery color space from its log format. We then got to work manually correcting our image when it comes to our luminance levels and our color balance. We started to get creative with our curves, dialing in a little bit more contrast and boosting our favored colors in the image. We then pushed our image into a quite stylized direction in our color wheels. And finally, we added that vignette just to kind of tie it all together. And through all of that, we monitored our scopes and we learned how to read those as we made changes to our image. And that's color grading in Premiere Pro in a nutshell. Let me know down in the comments how you like to grade in Premiere. Do you kind of follow this approach like I do? Or are you someone who likes to start off with a correction LUT, or even someone who likes to manually correct and then apply a big creative LUT to take your look to that next level? Either way, I hope this video has helped you either get started in Premiere Pro with color grading, or at least made you feel a little bit more confident in navigating those tools that you were already kind of playing around with in the Lumetri tab. Either way, thank you for checking out the tutorial. And until next time, happy grading.